worship now.
Snowy day. But I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I wonder if we could just give him a hand clap of praise as we get started. Everybody, I wonder if we could just give him a hand clap of praise as we enter in this morning. I know God has got great things in store for us this morning. But I wanted to share something just really quickly. Many of us are familiar with the tabernacle. And there were so many different pieces of furniture in the tabernacle. You had the golden candlesticks, and you had the altar of incense, and you had the table of showbread, and you had the courtyard. You had many articles in that tabernacle, at the Ark of the Testimony, all these things. But everybody was not allowed access into those places, some of those places. There were only priests and high priests that were allowed to go into certain portions of that tabernacle. But I love in Psalm 84 and 2, the psalmist said, "My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God." Though many were not able to go into the holy place and the holiest of holies, everybody was allowed access. If you were an Israelite, you could go into the courts. You were allowed to go and praise the Lord. The courts was an all-inclusive place. Everybody that wanted to lift up a praise, wanted to give thanksgiving, were given that opportunity. And I just feel like today, man, this is the courts of the Lord. It don't matter if you've been here a week or you've been here 20 years. All of us, everybody has allowed access to praise and give thanksgiving unto the Lord. I wonder if somebody in here just feels like giving the Lord a mighty shout of praise as we open up this morning. With your whole heart, if your heart cries out for God right now, could you give him your best praise? Lift him up as they begin to sing. Can you just begin to lift him up? We love you, Jesus. We long for you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Oh, said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord.
I was glad, so glad.
I was so glad.
I was glad, so glad.
I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord.
I was glad, so glad.
I was so glad.
I was glad, so glad.
Thankful to be in the church this morning. It's each and every person. And I'm so thankful for what God is doing. And I'm so thankful that we're a part of what God is doing. And we get to worship and we get to do it in many ways, but I'm so thankful that we're able to give of our tithes and our offerings. It's such a blessing, and I think many can attest to what God has done for us and through us by these principles, and they're eternal. And so I'm thankful at this time. We have so many ways we can give. We can give via the church app, Christian Life Church app, or if you want to go on the website, cltmemphis.org, or we can use the East Foyer, and there's envelopes, drop boxes. And God's expanding this thing. God's going to keep expanding this thing. And I'm just thrilled to see how the natural and the spiritual is going to connect. And we're going to add more and more and more and more and more. And I'm so thankful to be a part of that. And while we're giving, Brother Patrick is going to come and announce the seed project this time.
You may be seated. Last week, we talked in depth about how many hours goes in a week how many hours are given to make these ministries go. And this week, we want to talk about all the positions that are filled every service. You know, the Seed Project is the theme for this year, and the focus is children of the kingdom, that you are a seed. And every service we have the media team, we have the sound team, we have the band, we have the front line in the choir. Aren't they doing an incredible job? All the practice that goes into that. We have ministry attendance every service. We have the first touch team. We have guest connection. We have service attendance. We have the nursery. We have the elements led by Sister Adams. We have our life kids teachers, the life teens, and we have coffee service. So every Sunday morning, last week, we had 77 positions filled to make the service happen. How incredible is that? Next Sunday morning, we have 89 positions that would need to be filled. On Sunday nights, last Sunday night, we had 39 positions. And next Sunday night, we have 47 positions. Every Wednesday night last Wednesday night we had 31 positions that were filled just to make the service happen. And this coming Wednesday we have 36 positions that will be available for people to serve. And I just want to encourage you that if you are looking to get involved, if you want to plant yourself into a ministry, there are opportunities for you to serve. You may not be frontline. That may not be your position. It may not be something that you want to serve in. You may not be in the choir, but you can help serve coffee. You can help make the coffee. You know, you can help some of our other teams. You can help assist teachers. You know, there are positions there available for you. So I want to remind you, on the 24th, we are having our ministry fair. And what we're going to do, this sanctuary, we're going to move the chairs. And there's going to be tables set up for all of these ministries. And you'll be able to talk to the ministry leaders to get more information. On the 24th, you'll be able to sign your name on a sheet saying that you are interested in that. And we'll get more information to you, and that'll be an awesome time for you to serve. God bless you.
You know, I was thinking in preparing for the service that this year, this month, we're talking about as being a seed and being planted in the kingdom of God. When I begin to think about what it means to be a seed doesn't get to choose where they're planted. But a seed trusts and surrenders to the planter because the planter knows the proper soil for that seed to be planted in. And I wonder what it would look like today if we as seeds, children of the kingdom, would surrender to our planter and know that he knows the soil that we're going to flourish in. And if we would surrender to that soil, that's when we can be most fruitful. And so we're about to sing a song about surrendering to him and giving him all that we have, letting him do with it what he chooses. So I wonder, as we begin to worship, if you could lift your hands and just begin to surrender to him and say, God, I'm surrendering to what you want to do with my life. I'm surrendering to where you want to plant me. I'm giving everything that I have to you right now. Take all I have. heaven these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Can you sing that? Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life,
pouring out my life,
gracefully broken. Here I am. Your
purpose in me, you won't forsake.
You will be with me.
You will be with me.
Here I am,
God,
arms wide open, pouring out my life,
pouring out my life,
gracefully. Pouring out my life.
Step across an aisle and greet somebody you hadn't met. Tell them it's good to see them.
God bless you. You can make your way back to your seats and be seated momentarily. Good to see everybody out on this snowy Sunday morning. And this is going to be our only service today. We are dismissing our evening service due to that stuff that's coming down out there. And it's supposed to be getting quite a bit worse this afternoon. And we want everybody to be safe. I'm just going to tell you, I don't like dismissing service, especially in revival. We are dealing with matters of ultimacy. We're dealing with the kingdom of God and souls. But at the same time, we're caught in this perpetual tension between the natural and the spiritual. And just the natural circumstances, I think it's an act of prudence. Let's dismiss the service. We have a number of our members that drive from quite a ways to get to church, but maybe this would be a good time to catch up on some rest, have somebody over to your house, and let's just take advantage of this afternoon and do some good things for the kingdom of God, even though we're not at church. Part of what God does when he visits with humanity is he heals the sick. And we believe in healing. We pray for it. It's part of our doctrine. It's in the Bible, the gifts of healing. And when you read through the Gospels, everywhere Jesus went, he healed people. Ministering to the sick is part of what God does. But fortunately, we live in a society where medical technology is just on the cutting edge. Like Brother Howard's preached to us, a lot of times when we're sick, our first recourse is not to say, God, I'm sick, I need a touch, but it's get me a pill, get me a doctor. And he has challenged us to let's reach for Jesus before we reach for the doctor. And by no means are we opposed to anybody getting medical treatment. We encourage that. In fact, one of the authors of the Bible was a physician. Jesus said, they that are sick need a physician, fact, Paul did not prescribe prayer for every sickness. Timothy had perpetual stomach issues, and he told him, drink a little wine for your stomach and your often infirmities. He did not say get in the prayer line. And so there are some things that prayer is not going to fix. There are some sick people that God is not going to heal. The lame man that sat there at the gate of Beautiful for 38 years, Jesus walked by that man dozens of times and ignored his sickness because it wasn't his time yet. And so I don't have time to get into the whole theology of healing, but suffice it to say, it's a real thing. And the service that we had here Wednesday night and some of our other services, there was a heavy focus on healing, and God has been doing some miracles. And so I want to have three people come and give their testimony that have received a supernatural healing from the Lord in this meeting. I want Sister Nelda Orlando to come and tell us what God did for her on Wednesday night.
It's the Lord. Wednesday night was my service. I mean, I'm sorry about y'all, but it was mine. So as he was preaching, Brother Andrew was preaching about you don't need to go to a chiropractor, or you're thinking about going to a chiropractor, and that was me. And so, but I have been struggling with this shoulder and right arm, just a really excruciating pain and progressively getting worse, and to the point where it was hurting to pick up Harper, and just, I mean, it was hurting to raise my arm and just things that, hello, I need my arm to work. And so when he was preaching that service, I said, okay, God, I have fixed my mind on this. You are going to heal me tonight. And so I took Harper to the bathroom, and then I was like, Harper, come on, we got to go. Mimi's got to go get a healing. And she's like, okay. So we run down here, and everybody is already lined up. And I said, God, I'm not leaving here until you heal me. And I threw my arms up, and it was hurting. And I said, I am not walking away from this altar until you heal me. And so I just kept praying and praying and praying and just thanking him for it, because I already knew that he was going to do it. And I just felt such strong presence inside me, not on me, but inside me, like a ball of fire. And I knew immediately all pain left. And Brother Howard, he came over, and he said, I feel like a miracle just took place right here. And I couldn't say nothing but just worship and pray, because God did it. And if he can do it for me, he can do it for y'all. We just got to have a made up mind that he is going to do it, because he don't lie.
Amen. Well, give God thanks for that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother Joe Crossan got a good touch from the Lord and just got a miracle. And I want him to come tell us what God did for him.
Thank you, Brother Adams. Praise the Lord, everybody. Well, as most of you know, I'm in the construction field. And as a young man, I worked pretty hard. And I hurt my back. And probably for the last 20 years, I've probably taken anywhere from 4 to 10 ibuprofen every day, along with other natural things just to dull the pain. And I've gotten prayed for, and honestly, like Brother Howard said, I just thought, well, it's not for me. And probably about a month ago, he had us all come up, get in a line, and I started praying for my healing, and I think Blaine came up, and he started praying for my back, and some others came up, and I'll be honest, y'all, I didn't feel a thing. And I went and sat back down. I was a little disappointed. I thought, well, here we go again, back to the Advil, you know. And but when we got in the car, I told my wife, I said, I believe I got healed. I'm just going to believe it. And I told the family a couple days later, I believe I got healed. And over the course of a few days, the back pain left, has not been back. And the other day, Lindsay said something about needing some Advil. And Mom said, go get it in the cabinet. She said, there's not any. And she said, I always knew that you kept up with the Advil. There was none, and I haven't taken any since, y'all. So God touched me.
Hallelujah. You suppose the Lord could do it again? Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Well, let's take a moment to give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Man, you can be seated. Well, the Caleb Wheeler got a miracle. He has, it's not been public, but has had some very serious health situation over the last number of months. We've talked a number of times and prayed together, and I want him to come and give you his story.
I'm probably kind of old school or either ignorant, but I've always believed that God was a healer. Even as a young person, I saw people get touched in a mighty, mighty way. And probably about 8 months ago or so, I began to have some severe head problems, issues with my headaches. I've never had issues like this before in my life, but it got very, very, very bad that I had some X-rays and things of that nature done. And I don't like going into the doctor very often, but I had to. I needed at least a diagnosis so I could report what God would do. But it continued to get worse, and they didn't really have an answer, to be honest with you, what was going on, what was wrong. But it even affected a couple of times I was scheduled to do things, and I was not able to hold up my end of the bargain because I was afraid that I might pass out or something very, very bad would happen. It's continued, and it would come and it would go, and I begin to just kind of wonder, you know, what is this? Because I didn't get much of an answer, stress and all this stuff, but I don't know if they're playing games or taking my money or what, but you know, I don't like either, and so I gave up on doctors and all that stuff a long time ago, even though I probably shouldn't, but. God's going to have to touch me. That's the only thing that I was persuaded about, was that God was going to do something. It began to get worse. And to be honest with you, even a few weeks ago, I was thinking, well, maybe I do need to go back to the doctor, schedule another appointment, something. Something's got to change. But Brother Howard kept preaching about healing. And I guess it's probably easy to believe for somebody else's healing. And I don't like to complain either, but you know, he was preaching, I guess it was Wednesday night, while he's preaching, before I didn't even come up here for prayer, while he was preaching, I began to feel something begin to shift in my head. I guess I forgot to say, a couple weeks ago in worship service, I began to jump up and down, and I had to sit down because I felt like I was about to pass out, and it was getting worse. But as he was preaching Wednesday night, I began to feel it change. Something began to change. Something, you could feel God begin to, I felt him begin to touch me. And then I come up here, was praying with a few other, somebody else, and then Brother Patrick came over to me, and he began to pray for me. I began to feel it just get better and better. Then Pastor Adams came over and he had laid hands on me. And I have not felt this good in a long time. I haven't felt the headaches, any of the situations, any of the problems, any of that stuff. I haven't felt any symptoms. So I want to tell whoever it is, as he begins to preach, whatever it is he's preaching, just grab a hold of the word. Don't hesitate. Just grab it with two hands, because God is still a healer. And he wants to heal you. And so just grab it with two hands and grab a hold of it. And God is still a healer.
Let's stand together. Well, I believe in the next few moments of this service, the presence of God is going to settle down in this room, and he's going to give us a word, and the Lord's going to do some more miracles right here in this room with this group of people before it's over. If you're ready for it, just ask the Lord right now to challenge your faith. God, stretch my faith, God. Stretch my faith, Lord. Let the anointing of your spirit be upon this man of God to preach to us. Open my ears to your word. In Jesus' name.
Let's just continue to reach out to the Lord right now. Just would you begin to lift your faith, grab a hold of what you've heard, and let that be confirmation of what the Lord does once, he will do again. Come on, let that be a sign to you, whatever you're facing, what he's done for them. He is no respecter of persons. He is willing to heal, to save, to fill, to forgive, to deliver. Whatever you need is in this house right now. Come on, if you're here with a need right now, would you just lift a hand? Just begin to lift your voice right now in the name of the Lord. Karabokusharakaya. Come on, if it's a need in your family, a need in your body, a need in your mind, in your spirit, whatever it is, God's able. Lift your faith right now. He is able to do both exceeding abundantly above all we can ask or think. In Jesus' name, today is someone's day. Today is the day. Come on, if you believe right now that God can do anything, and he'll do it today, and he'll do it for you right here in this service, would you begin to lift up a shout of praise unto the Lord? Somebody lift your voice and shout with a voice of triumph right now. Shandakaya. Hallelujah. We give you praise. Oh, let's give him high praise all across this building right now. Can we magnify? Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. We give you glory, praise, and honor today, God. You're worthy. You're great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. We are an apostolic church, and the apostolic church is simply the continuation of the New Testament church. And I don't mean to cross swords with you today, but there's not many roads leading to heaven. And that's what popular mainstream religion and television preachers will tell you, but the Bible says that there's only one way, one path, and one door. And today I'm telling you that the power of God is in this house. An apostolic church is not simply apostolic because it baptizes in Jesus' name and people talk in tongues. But an apostolic church, to be apostolic, must have miracles, signs, and wonders, or it's not apostolic. I don't care what your standard is, what your theology is, if it is absent of miracles, signs, and wonders, it is not what this book says it should be. I'm thankful to be in an apostolic church today. How about you? Amen. I'm thankful that we do more than talk about a God that can do things, but that we believe that God will do it, that he'll do it here, that he does it all the time, that he'll do it for anybody. Amen. If you're in this house and you need a miracle in your body, if you need the Holy Ghost, I've got great news. You don't have to fill out a background check. You don't have to have your citizenship in a certain status. You don't have to be from a certain part of town. You don't even have to have ever been here before. If you're breathing oxygen today, you're qualified to receive something from the Lord. He wants to, if you don't have the Holy Ghost, He wants to give it to you today. If you need a healing, He wants to heal. Well, what if God doesn't want to heal me? I'm going to tell you how I view the miraculous. I just believe He intends to heal, and I'll let Him deal with the details. Hallelujah. Amen. I want the Lord to help us today, and He is going to do just that. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to go to a few different references and a couple of different books here. You can read along with me or listen. Matthew chapter 12 and verse 22. We'll be reading Luke in Luke chapter 11. And we'll be flipping back to Matthew chapter 6. I'm going to bounce around here a little bit, so bear with me. Matthew chapter 12. I want to say how important it was that we heard these testimonies today. This was very crucial. And we've got to hear more. And there's more sitting out here that, for whatever reason or another, you've been a little hesitant. But I am challenging you right now, share your testimony. Not just here, but everywhere that you go, share the testimony. That's a part of the miracle. Amen. Matthew 12, verse 22. Then was brought unto him one possessed with a devil, blind and dumb, and he healed him, insomuch that the blind and dumb both spake and saw. And all the people were amazed and said, Is not this the son of David? But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, This fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, or Satan, the prince of the devils. And Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And if Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How shall then his kingdom stand? And if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore they shall be your judges. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Luke chapter 11 and verse number 20. But if I with the finger of God cast out devils, no doubt the kingdom of God is come upon you. Verse number 2 of the same chapter. And he said unto them, When ye pray, say, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done as in heaven, so in earth. You don't have to turn there. Matthew 6 and 10, the same story being referenced. Jesus says, Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. You know, this morning, I'm going to preach to you from this thought, the coming kingdom. The coming kingdom. I believe the Lord wants to minister to everyone that is here today. We've got one shot at this today, and we're fixing to use it. I want us to lift our hands and lift our voices. Would you lift your faith right now? Would you begin to push? We don't have Sunday night. We just got right here, right now. Let's start pushing now. Would you lift your voice with me? In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we bind every spirit of hell, every spirit of unbelief, doubt, and fear in Jesus' name, and command it to leave this house right now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we lose faith to operate among this body in Jesus' name. Would you release ministering spirits among your people here today? Would you heal? Would you deliver? Would you save? Would you redeem? Would you set the captive free today? In the name of Jesus, if you're believing God to meet a need in your life, would you lift your voice right now? Come on, would you begin to tell him, God, I believe that today is a day that this is, come on, I want you to say it with faith. This is my moment. This is my time. This is my opportunity. Today, something's changing. Come on, that sister testified earlier, I'm not leaving without a miracle. Is there 10 of you here today that would let that kind of determination get on you? I'm not leaving until something breaks, until something changes. If you believe it's happening, praise him again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise him with expectation. Hallelujah. We praise you, God. We magnify you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. You can be seated. We find that Jesus commissions two groups of people. The Bible says that he commissioned 70, and he commissioned the 12 disciples. And he told them to go, and he gave them authority and power. And he said to preach the gospel of the kingdom and to heal the sick and to cast out the devil. He said, when you pray for them, tell them that the kingdom of God has come to them. When they are healed in their body, when the devil is cast out of them, tell them the kingdom of God has come unto you. That this is a sign of the coming kingdom. This is a declaration that heaven's kingdom is coming down. Praise the Lord. It was a concept that Jesus was trying to drive. The coming kingdom surpasses the existing kingdom. The kingdom that is coming to earth is greater than anything that man has ever built. It's more beautiful than any palace or structure that's ever been built. It's more powerful than the greatest military might that's ever marched across this planet. Hallelujah. It can accomplish more than the greatest system of government that's ever been put into place. The coming kingdom is going to eventually override the kingdom that now exists. Jesus is saying, don't settle for this kingdom and don't waste your time trying to build your own kingdom. I don't care what your level of success may be in life. I don't care if you're the most wealthiest person in Memphis. If it has not happened already, there will come a day where everything that you have built and worked for will leave you with emptiness. But the coming kingdom is greater than anything you can labor for. Anything that you, come on, there's nothing on this earth that can compare to the kingdom of God. To the kingdom that he wants to loose across the city of Memphis today. Oh, hallelujah. He said there is a better kingdom that is coming. That what we see and what we feel so restricted by is temporary. I believe that's as much of a relevant message then. And it's relevant right now, right here today. We feel restricted by the current kingdom. But I'm telling you that this restriction is temporary. We feel inhibited. And that feeling may grow before much more time passes. But I'm telling you, it is temporary. There is a coming kingdom. And as a kingdom of freedom, a kingdom of liberty. A kingdom that does not seek to put people in bondage, but that comes to set the captive free. A kingdom that does not force people to align themselves with its theology, but allows people to make their own choice. If you're going to be in this kingdom, honey, you've got to choose to be in it. I said, if you're going to be a part of the kingdom of God, that's a choice you've got to make. And you can make that decision right here today. Praise God. He sends them to preach the kingdom of God. Every time that you heal, say the kingdom of God has come unto you. They must understand it. They must hear it. The kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom. The disciples were convinced that Jesus was using them to establish a political kingdom, that there would be a moment where he would draw a sword and take the throne and be the rightful king that they supposed him to be. Practicing Jews today still believe that the Messiah will be a political figure. As they approached Jerusalem, they asked him, "Will you at this time restore the kingdom? Are you going to exercise political power? Are you going to rally a military force and overthrow the current kingdom?" His response is, "My kingdom is not of this world. And we're not going to fight in a physical battle. But my kingdom is from somewhere else. My kingdom has power that this world has never seen. My kingdom surpasses the greatest military, the greatest leader, the greatest financial system, the greatest healthcare system. Honey, you ain't never seen nothing like the kingdom of God. You ain't never been a part of anything as wonderful as the kingdom of God. It's time for you to join it today." Praise God. My kingdom is not man's concept of what a kingdom is. Man's idea of a kingdom is a government body that rules with an iron fist, that lays out laws and mandates, and you must comply or else. Everyone must have the same train of thought. Everyone must acquiesce to the wishes of the kingdom. The kingdom is not necessarily concerned about the people. Boy, have we ever gotten a I'm not here to harp on all of the negativity today, but we are quickly getting a revelation, not just here, but around the world, that earthly kingdoms are for themselves and not for the people. Modern day kingdoms are kingdoms of corruption. I don't care what brand, what party, what stripe, what side, or in the middle that they might be. They are kingdoms of corruption. But the kingdom of heaven, it comes with healing, it comes with liberty, it comes with power, it comes with salvation, it comes with mercy, it comes with forgiveness, it comes with grace. I wish I had somebody that believe what I'm saying right now. It is a far superior kingdom. Praise God. The kingdom of God will be populated by people that choose to be there. The kingdom of God will never be full of people that have their arm twisted and have their ear pulled, because God don't operate that way. Hallelujah. The kingdom of God will be full of people that willingly choose to be there. And if you're going to choose to be in the kingdom of God, then that means you're also going to have to choose to leave some things behind. Preaching to somebody right now. If you're going to be in the, if you're going to choose to come into the kingdom, then you're going to have to choose to come out of something else. Hallelujah. I just feel this right now in the Holy Ghost. I don't know who I'm talking to. The Lord told Abraham, get out of your family, come out of your culture, come out of your religion, and come into the land or the kingdom I've called you into. I'm going to tell somebody right now, you need to come out of your racist culture. You might need to separate yourself from some family and some friends or whoever else you're connected to and come into the kingdom of God. I had no intention of preaching this morning. I'm going to tell you right now, the words ought never come out of my mouth. I'm proud to be white. I'm proud to be black. I'm proud to be Latino. Honey, you need to be proud to be a child of God. All the rest of that is irrelevant. That is man's kingdom, not God's kingdom. Come on. You ought to rejoice that your name has been written in heaven. I had no choice over this, but I choose to be here. I could not choose my mama, but I chose to go down in water in the only saving name of Jesus. Come out of your culture, honey, and get in the kingdom. There's freedom in this kingdom. That kingdom is a kingdom of bondage and slavery. Come out. Come out and be separate. I felt something break right there in the spirit. We're not building a Spanish church. We're not building an English church. We're not building a white church. We're building God's church. And the Lord, the Bible said, added daily such as should. And he'll add whoever he wants to add. And he'll bring whoever he wants to bring. I don't care what lifestyle they come from. I don't care if they don't know what their gender is. He will save who he chooses to save. The best thing you can do is get in the kingdom and get rid of your old culture and your own mentalities. Oh, let's praise him for just a moment. Thank God for his kingdom. Help us, God. In the kingdom, race is irrelevant. I'm going to say it again. I had no intention of coming here and dealing with this, but there's something here that's provoking God to deal with it. In the kingdom, race and color is totally irrelevant, that it never crosses his mind. Maybe it's a hang up for you, but God doesn't give it an ounce of consideration. And if you're going to be in his kingdom, maybe you ought to align yourself with it. Don't ever expect this church to line up with some kind of mentality that you brought here. You need to come out of that and step into what he's calling you into. Maybe that was your way of surviving some other way, some other place in your life, but God's saying, I've got a better plan. I've got a better place. Come up and come out. Come up a little higher. Let me show you a more perfect way. Somebody receive it right now. Somebody receive it right now. Take that junk out of your mind. Take that junk out of your mouth. Get it out of your spirit. There is no room for that in his kingdom. There will be not one racist in heaven. I'm going to say it again. I don't care what your grandma thought or what my grandpa said. There will not be one person that hates somebody else for something they could not change that will be there. No hatred in his kingdom. Believe what you, I don't care what your family history is. No hatred will be there. There will be no strife. There will be no war. There will be no fighting. Somebody needs to just settle this. I feel this in the Holy Ghost. You've been sitting here for weeks and months, maybe longer, and you've questioned, can I go to church here? Can I be a member here? Will I ever fit here? Honey, you'll start fitting here when you start changing your mindset. Come on, choose to think differently. Choose to live differently. Stop looking at the differences and look at what unites us. Come on, we're in the kingdom of God. I don't care if all your family and friends are still trapped out there. I don't have to think that way. I don't have to live that way. Woo. Help us, God. While we're at it, all the people that you're running with, if they're all cussing, living in perversion, you need to come out of that world and get in the kingdom. Stop letting those people influence you. I don't know who I'm talking to today. You're hanging around people. I don't care if they claim to talk in tongues. All they want to do is trash this church and run your pastor down. You need to come out and be separate. You need to unfollow and be separate. You need to hang up the phone and be separate. You need to stop running with them, listening to them, interacting with them, and get in the kingdom. Things are a lot more clear in the kingdom. It's hazy and foggy out there, but you can see clearly. There's clarity in the kingdom of God. Only in the kingdom of God can he unite people from every walk of life. Can he unite broken people, dysfunctional people, messed up people, people that society said there ain't a chance with them. Only in the kingdom. Show me somewhere else where it's happening. You want to tell me about the programs the city of Memphis is putting on? Show me the statistics of how successful they are. It's a joke. And I know people mean well, and they're trying the best they can, but it don't work in man's kingdom. Only in the kingdom of God is there real lifelong deliverance from addiction and devils. Only in the kingdom of God can God burn out the hate and put love inside of you. I'm going to say it. I don't care who it offends. Only in the kingdom of God can he take a black panther and a white skinhead and take all, I've seen it happen, take out the hatred and put a love in them like they've never known, where they don't see the difference. And no, is this too much for Memphis? Can I preach what I feel and you still get with me? Come on, only in the kingdom of God. Only in the kingdom of God. Come out and join the kingdom. Join the kingdom. Everything you need is in the kingdom. Woo. Financial blessing is in the kingdom. Open doors are in the kingdom. Provision is in the kingdom. Prosperity is in the kingdom. Revival is in the kingdom. Woo. This world is worrying, and they're fixing to worry a lot more as things unfold of what's going to happen. How are we going to make it? If you're in the kingdom, you don't have to worry. If you're sitting around every day with anxiety because you don't know what your job's looking like, what the future holds, is our income going to remain intact? You need to come out and get in the kingdom. You need to come out of that place in your mind. If you're wrapped up with anxiety, I don't know how we're going to make it. What's the government going to do next? How's all this going to unfold? Honey, when you come out of that place and get in the kingdom, you don't have to worry anymore. The one who rules the kingdom is making the decisions. He's taking care of everything. He's already got everything that you need. He's already got tomorrow taken care of. He's one step ahead of the government and anybody else. He's not taken by surprise, and he's not concerned. So if you're in the kingdom, you shouldn't be concerned either. Jesus, he is in control. You believe that today? I said he's in control. Praise God. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. A priority of prayer, he said, is praise and the kingdom before you pray for forgiveness or blessing. Before you pray for provision, pray about the kingdom. Thy kingdom come. Let your kingdom come to earth. Let your kingdom be manifested for the world to see. How is the kingdom manifested? When I cast out devils, the kingdom has come unto you.
In Acts, the second chapter, the kingdom of God came down into an upper room and it filled the hearts of men, and they began to speak with tongues as the Spirit gave. What was that? That was the kingdom coming down. Come on, 3,000 people in the streets of the city speaking with tongues. The kingdom was raining down all across the city. When you see someone speak in tongues, the kingdom of God has come down. When you see someone testifying, I was healed in my body and God did what the doctor couldn't, the kingdom of God has come unto you. Come on. When God takes addiction out of your body that you've had for 20 years, the kingdom of God has come unto you. You believe that today? Do you believe he's able to do it again in this service? Come on, let's push this thing a little further. We're not settling for one night of miracles. Come on, it needs to become the constant norm in CLT. Let this be what you are known for. Let it be named among you. This is a church where the supernatural is loosed, where miracles, signs, and wonders happen. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I want it to look like on the earth what it looks like in heaven. Thy will be done on the earth as it's already been done in heaven. When you're healed, the kingdom has come. Why did he say that over and over? There's a connection the Lord is wanting to make. In the kingdom of God, there is no sickness. And so when someone is healed, that's a flash of the kingdom. That's a sign. If you're going to a church that doesn't have that, you need to make up your mind. Do you want to be religious? Do you want to keep living by tradition? Or do you want to join the kingdom? I don't care if they have the word church on the front of the building, if they read out of some form of a Bible, if there's no signs, if people aren't being filled with the Holy Ghost, if people aren't being healed in their body, if the devil is not being cast out, if people are not being freed from addiction, it is not his church and it is not a part. I don't care what they claim to believe. Signs shall follow them that believe. You can believe or you can talk, but when there's real believers, the signs accompany. This is a church full of believers. The kingdom of God has come down in CLT. I wouldn't waste another service sitting in some dead, dull church going through some rotten tradition of men that you couldn't find in Scripture if you tried. I wouldn't waste the time sitting through another dead dog sermon where nobody's helped, where nobody's healed, but you got you a free latte before you got to leave, honey. I want to go where people are getting healed, where cancers are disappearing, where broken bones are coming together, where marriages are being mended. That's where I want to be. It only happens in the kingdom. Heaven, he said he would wipe away every tear. There's no depression there. Did you hear me? There's no depression there. So why should there be depression here? Are you in the kingdom? There's no anxiety there, which means he wants you to live anxiety free here. Thy will be done on earth as it is. Let this reflect what you've already accomplished. Let what is there come down. Thy kingdom come. Not going to be anybody walking around heaven full of cancer. Nobody's going to be limping through heaven. There'll be no disfigurement in heaven. No Parkinson's in heaven. No back pain in heaven. No hunger. No poverty in heaven. Somebody needs to come out of where you are and get in the kingdom. Come on, I'm preaching to some apostolics. You're settling for another kingdom. His kingdom is free of all of those things. Come out. Come out and be a part of. Have some of you decided to settle? I'm telling you right now, his kingdom is intended to be free of pain, free of anxiety. Some people have determined and decided that you can be partially apostolic, but still covered up with all of the problems of this world. That you've just got to accept some things. Why? Because Christian experts have said so, or because the Bible said? What voices are we listening to in Pentecost? People I keep hearing, large groups listening to, keep falling by the wayside. Experts keep falling by the wayside. I'm going to tell you, God's word is true. And it's not changing. And it's going to be proven to be more true than it's ever been proven before. Let God be true and every man a liar. So I don't care what the expert says. If it conflicts with the word of God, I'm going to take God's word and his opinion over the voice of the expert. Do you hear what I'm saying tonight? I believe you can be a child of God and be totally free of depression. I really feel a pushback in here. I don't know where it's coming from, but I'm going to say it until I feel something shift. I believe you can live for God and be free from depression. Believe it or don't believe it, you can choose to live with it, but I choose to be in the kingdom. I choose to believe he's got power over the depression that's coming against me. He's got power over the circumstances that have brought the depression. He's got power over my anxiety. He's got power over the fear that has gripped your family, but somebody has to believe it. Get in the kingdom and let God be what he already is. The kingdom, his kingdom, is pain-free, conflict-free, oppression-free, addiction-free, disease-free, family problem-free. There's no black corner in heaven. There's no white corner in heaven. It's not a Latino avenue. You're baptized into one body, into one spirit. In the kingdom, there's a unification under one God, under one name, one body, a coming together, a combination. That is what happens in the kingdom. Stop trying to do your thing and still claim to be in the church. Get up, get in, and be a part of what God is doing. Join the kingdom. I feel the Holy Ghost trying to work right now. Let's just lift our hands and let's begin to reach out to the Lord right now. All across this room, come on. Would you lift your voice right now? Somebody open your spirit, open your heart right now. I don't care what you're dealing with today. God is able to break it. God is able to set you free. In the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Heaven will be free of all earthly limitations.
When you cast out the devil, tell them the kingdom of God has come. Let them know this is what they can expect to enter into. This is a taste of what is to come. Don't force people to come to your church service. Why don't you take the kingdom to them? I said, don't wait until somebody shows up on Sunday. Why don't you take the kingdom that is in you? Don't you realize that how many have the Holy Ghost speaking with tongues in this house? Wherever you go, the kingdom is going. I said, wherever you go, the kingdom of God has just walked into that business. And disease is subject to the kingdom. Sickness is subject to the power of the kingdom. Come on, let somebody see what the, don't keep it bottled up. Let them see what the kingdom looks like. How will they ever want to be a part until they catch a glimpse? The kingdom of God has come unto you. Come on, you can lay hands on the sick in your office building and sickness disappear. Demonic oppression leave. Fear has to go. Anxiety can lift and tell them this is only a taste of what God can do. The kingdom has come. Something's trying to break in the culture of this church. I'm just going to say everything I feel and hold nothing back and let the chips fall where they may. Help me, Holy Ghost. There's a lot of what we do, not necessarily anything wrong with it, but a lot of what we do, the apostolic church has absorbed from the denominational religious world. I hear preach against all of it, but this right here is his original plan and format. And we have tried, you know, there was a time when Pentecost was raw and gritty and dirty, and we were looked down on, and we were low class. But we tried to reach a place of affluence. We wanted to be like all the other denominations that were widely accepted. We began to clean up our image. And guess what? Still not accepted. Isn't that funny how that worked out? Still don't want to hear what we've got to say. Still don't want our preachers praying in political meetings. Come on. He never promised acceptance. He said, I promise you, you will be hated. I'm not here to push all that today, but that's in the book. I'm telling you right now, we need a resurgence and a revival of miracles, signs, and wonders, not just in church services where the preacher says, hey, tonight there's going to be miracles. That just needs to become the norm. You need to come to this church every service, even if it's a prayer meeting, even if it's a session on leadership, saying somebody could be healed tonight in their body. Somebody could get the Holy Ghost in Bible study tonight. We need to be prepared. It doesn't matter what we're doing. If needs walk into this building, it can be changed. Come on. It's not the occasion. It's not every now and then in the kingdom. It's all the time. All that enter into the kingdom can be set free from whatever has them in bondage. If it's sin, if it's disease. Now it's time to take this out there. You know what? I'm ready to see it. I'm seeing it happen in places. We're waiting until people can come in and sit through our religious services. Because the atmosphere, you know, that's what gets them. But you have the kingdom in you. Why not, when you're teaching the Bible study, that you pray before you sit down
and say, Lord, tonight as we're teaching this Bible study, I'm just believing this, you're going to move. And when I start feeling you move, I'm going to give them a chance to pray. I'm believing it's fixing to happen. If it's one, if it's 50, that we're going to start teaching Bible studies out of this church and start getting calls and texts. Hey, we got three people talking in tongues right here in their living room. We was just teaching a Bible study, but the kingdom came down. Come on. Come on, bring the kingdom to where you are. Don't keep it in your building. The kingdom of God is in you. Take it to the world. Take it outside of these walls. We need miracles to start happening all over the city of Memphis. Well, I'm just afraid if I pray and nothing happens, I'm going to look stupid. Well, what if you pray and something does happen and they get the Holy Ghost and tell 50 people about it? You'll never know until you let the kingdom come out. It's not your power. It's the power of the kingdom. It's not what you are. It's what's in you. I've got the kingdom. The kingdom of God is called Shabbakosaya. Somebody believe right now. I don't want God to simply use me to pray for saints of God on a Wednesday night. I'm ready for God to use me to pray for the manager, to pray for my coworker, to pray for my neighbor. Come on. Somebody join with me right now. God's trying to stretch this church. Come on, don't let the spirit of quarantine remain on you any longer. The quarantine spirit says it's all about me and my problem and my issue. But I'm telling you right now, we've got to shake that off the church once and for all and say the kingdom is about others. The kingdom is about reaching those that are broken, those that have fallen, those that are down and out. Somebody rally with me right now. Come on, shake yourself out of the quarantine doldrums. Make up your mind. I'm not living like this. I'm not thinking like this. I feel the Holy Ghost working right now. Miracles, signs, and wonders are flashes of the coming kingdom. And if you don't have that, you're not in the kingdom. Help us, Holy Ghost. The kingdom of man is corrupted by nature. It's falling apart. I don't care who they elect. I don't care who they vote in. It's going to fall apart. Because man is corrupt. Man is fallible. Man is so limited. But the kingdom of God is unlimited. It cannot be saved, this kingdom that we are forced to be surrounded by. But we can bring his kingdom to earth. Be in the world, but not of the world. I may be forced to live here and to put up with what we're putting up with. But in the midst of all that, the kingdom can come. Thy kingdom come down. Come on, we need a move of God to sweep through here this Sunday morning. I'm not here to teach to you today. There needs to be a demonstration of his spirit and power here in this service. Right now, I'm almost done. But I wish everybody in this room would stir up the gift of God that is within you right now. God wants to manifest himself in this house in the name of Shokurakasaya. Anobokoshereankaya. Come on, let's push for just a minute right now. In fact, someone join me on the music. Come on, stir it up right now. Come on, I know the weather's crazy and you're going to go home in just a little while, but right now, for the next little bit of time that we have, why don't we pray the kingdom down? Come on, why don't we bring heaven to earth today and let God do what he wants to do? Why don't we see if God wouldn't welcome somebody else into the kingdom? Why don't we see if God wouldn't rid somebody else of sickness?
Lift your faith right now. In the name of Rebosenei, stand to your feet all across this house if you would. There's a reason we're not out joining all these protests and causes, because that's not the kingdom. His kingdom is a kingdom of peace, not violence. Maybe I've touched your hot button issue, but it could be that God's trying to speak to you right now. Jesus, help us, God. His kingdom is one free of pain and free of sin. And if you're going to be a part of the kingdom, he will set you free from sin. All you've got to do is ask him. Jesus, I'm a wreck. I'm a mess. I'm broken. I've made a lot of mistakes, and I'm asking you to forgive me. I don't want to live like this any longer. Is it really that simple? It's just that simple. It is not hard. It is not complicated to get the Holy Ghost. You can receive it right now while I'm talking. The Holy Ghost, what you have been feeling, is not emotion. That is the Spirit of God. That is the Holy Ghost. And God would fill every person that wants it right here today. Some of you need a renewing of the Holy Ghost. God can do that today. He will forgive your sin the moment that you ask him to do so. That's all it takes. I don't care if your family's held your mistakes over your head all your life. Just one moment with Jesus. One moment with Jesus. Anybody believe that? Anybody been forgiven of their sins? Anybody felt the weight of sin lift off you? The weight of addiction, the weight of years of abuse and pain lift. Anybody felt that? He'll do that for anybody. For anybody that wants it. There's no demonic possession in the kingdom. There's no wars. There's no division. There's no, we're on this side and we're on that side. Not in the kingdom. I feel the kingdom in this house right now. Anybody else feel it? I don't care what you're dealing with today. I don't care if you need healing for your body, for your mind, for your family, for your marriage, whatever your situation is. If you need the Holy Ghost right now as they begin to play, if you have a need, I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's just so insurmountable, it's way over your head, you don't know how to deal with it. I want you to come right now, and I want you to believe the kingdom is coming down today, and that God's fixing to meet needs. Come on. Come on quickly. If whatever your need is, if you believe that God would meet it today, come on down. If you believe that God has an answer, come right now. Come on, make your move right now. Come on, as they begin to walk to this altar, are there any believers that believe that his kingdom would come? Would you find someone in this front right now that you could come and minister to? Come on, those that are in the kingdom, minister to those that are trying to get in the kingdom. Come on, minister one to another right now. Come on, let this become common among us. Come on, there is an anointing upon the body to minister to each other. Come on, come on, let God use you right now. If you're a part of the kingdom, come on, would you respond with us right now? Would you pray? Would you find someone to pray with or pray for yourself? Whatever the situation may be, come on, right now, right now, right now. Come on, every apostolic, I want us to push right now with everything you've got. Come on, no one spectating. Let's all find someone we can work with right now. Would you push? Would you push? If we'll pray, his kingdom will come. If we'll reach, his kingdom will come.
Earth is shaking. Chains are breaking. Let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come.
this house. This is what I want you to do right now. I want us to act like we're a part of a greater kingdom. I want you to find someone right now. I don't care if it's a saint, if it's a guest. Find someone right now you can minister to. I believe there's more miracles God's about to loose in the next few minutes. Come on, right now, if you need something from the Lord, come on, don't stand around. If you need God to break something, He'll do it right now. Come on, find someone you can pray for. Find someone you can reach right now. Come on, this is somebody's moment. The kingdom is coming down. The kingdom is coming. His kingdom is in this house. Come on, receive what the Lord would do. Receive what the Lord would do. In the name of Jesus, receive it.